Ropp is here with us, and Garth as well. I'm Eric, and we have something cool to share with you.
Yeah. Anna, welcome to your podcast.
Thanks.
Yeah, this is really important. We wanted to do it the right way. Instead, we're just going to do it.
Sounds good. Let's go.
You're presuming that there is a right way. And so I don't know where we're going to go here. We're going to wing it, and hopefully you'll be patient with us and Anna will forgive us.
Eric, I remember when you came out to Seattle a couple of years ago, and we did, a one-day psych sessions retreat, and we filled a whiteboard with ideas. And one of those ideas was to get folks information about scholarship of teaching and learning, particularly for folks who didn't have, like, we were aware that high school teachers did not have access to this information. And then a lot of people would just find something like a SoTL Psych Sessions interesting. And so we kind of put that on the back burner. And then we revisited it a couple years later. Do you remember that?
Yeah. You know, the rate limiting factor, I think, for all of us in our busy lives is time. And there's so much good stuff coming out of so many journals in psychology and outside of psychology for that matter. And, you know, occasionally one of us will have time to grab a journal and read it and digest it, which is awesome. And you might see a post on Twitter or Facebook or Instagram. But the notion was that it kind of evolved over time. You know, what if someone, you know, could curate interviews with authors either as their work is coming out, so it'd be kind of hot off the press and get the scoop, if you will, or if they went back and they went and talked to authors of like seminal works, like classic works in the scholarship of teaching and learning, and did interviews about, you know, how did you come up with the idea? And you know, what are the practical applications for my classroom? And I think there's a couple of interesting notions in there. One is that it gives authors a chance to promote either their new work or their previous work, but also it also gives, you know, listeners and readers a shortcut and almost a preview, an enticement to go read the article. And even if they don't have time to read the article, at least they got an explanation in the author's own words. However, to do that's an arduous task. It takes time. Garth and I knew that we didn't have the time. So Garth and I put our heads together and we did a national search for someone. And we came up with someone and who was our number one pick who said yes.
That's you, Anna.
I know. I'm thinking national search. I just got an email that says, hey, you want to talk about this?
We didn't tell you the stuff that went behind it. No, seriously. I mean, Garth and I are pretty well connected in the U.S. with regards to the folks who are specialists in teaching and learning in psych and who are in, you know, the tribe. And the tribe is pretty big. You look around at the talent in Division II and SDP and the affiliated, you know, regional meetings and the talented psych-chi folks, and there's hundreds and hundreds of people to choose from.
Well, Anna, so you got an email from us with this idea for SoTL Psych Sessions, and we told you we were reaching out to you because we thought that if you were interested, that people would really like to hear you host this thing, and we were hoping that you would want to do that. So maybe just tell our listeners what that process was like for you when you heard this idea. And then we'll maybe move through kind of chronologically the last couple months as you've been recording the first few episodes of SoTL Psych Sessions.
Yeah, sounds good. So the email was just, you know, would you like to talk about, I can't remember, an opportunity. And, you know, we worked together on some things. I'm like, sure. So I didn't hear about the idea until we were on the Zoom call. And by the way, I have this sort of standard that if somebody asks me to do something or there's an opportunity, that I need to sleep on it. Because for those of you that know me, I overcommit. I get really excited. Yeah. Eric's laughing. Sure. Yeah. It's an understatement, yeah. Probably. But I get excited and then I forget, you know, like I have to fit this in with everything else. And so I actually, my standard, my rule, I entirely broke it before we got off the call. I was like, I am in. Like, sounds good. And my only caveat to that was because it was spring 2020 when we had all gone remote, my only thing was, can I start in summer?
It's interesting that you probably don't know this, but Eric and I were going to wait. This was Eric's idea. We were going to wait to see you at Rocky Mountain and to have the conversation in person. And then when that fell through, we were like, well, screw it. We'll give her a call. We'll talk to her on Zoom because the world's falling apart and we need to get this going. So,
well, I'm glad you did.
Yeah. The other thing I want to mention is that, Anna, one of the reasons why you popped for us in terms of, I think, a perfect host is that you and I had a conversation at the prior ACT in Phoenix. And I picked up this trick from Regan. He remembers conversations by where he was and what meal he had. You and I were in a coffee shop in Phoenix after fountain pen shopping. I don't know if you remember that.
Oh, yeah. In a strip mall. Yeah.
Yeah. And you were telling me about the SoTL research that you were doing. And you had a series of studies mapped out. And you had done, I think, the first couple. And you had like two more. You know, you had mapped out a program of research. And we had just been chit-chatting about what you'd found so far and what you were planning. And so, you know, you're an active SoTL researcher yourself. You're submitting manuscripts. You're reading the literature. You're teaching at a state university. I mean, so it kind of all fell into place. You have national recognition through STP as well as Rocky Mountain Psychological Association. So I just wanted to add to the listeners, you know, that you've got that street cred, that you're doing it. And so, you know, talking to researchers was just a perfect next step.
I thought it was a great idea, especially for people, like you said, who might not have the time to sit down and try to figure out, like, what does this research say? And also for, you know, people who teach psychology, who, like, teachers at high school who may not have access to journal articles or, you know, may not be in the same conversations that those of us that do SoTL research do. So it's, you know, I thought it was a fabulous idea. And then to get to talk to people about their research sounded lovely.
One of the other things that just makes you perfect for this this hosting of a new arm of Psych Sessions is that you really do have the trust of people. I see in social media, particularly in Twitter, you are constantly interacting with folks on there, and the things that you're saying are really well received. It's like you have this ability to talk to people where they're at, and so there is this, like, I don't think anybody can come in and just host and connect to audience. I think that, you know, one of the things that made you really, really attractive to us as well is that you really can connect to people in a meaningful way. And as I've already heard in the first few episodes that our listeners are going to hear soon, that you pick topics also that are really meaningful and relevant to educators and to the time that we're in.
Yeah, I mean, I feel really fortunate that, so for the listeners, Garth and Eric just said, you get to pick who you talk to, what research you are going to highlight. And I'm, you know, that's exciting to me. And so as we were coming into, you know, the summer and, you know, as we're going to be coming into the fall semester, I was thinking, okay, what can I choose that would be helpful to people? And so I've got, you know, some things about online teaching for those of you like me who have actually never done it are expected to do it now. And then, you know, my interest, which if you follow me on social media, you probably know, I think it says something about social justice in my bio, and you can definitely tell that when you follow me on social media. So we've got some interesting episodes for everybody.
Well, and what I like, Anna, is that, you know, actually maybe I take that back. What I dislike really is that you're making it look easy so quickly. and it's really kind of disgusting to me, quite honestly, because it takes a while for the rest of us to kind of figure this out. I mean, when the listeners get a chance to listen to you interviewing people, and many of these people you've never met before. So you're talking to people who you've invited, they've said yes, and you're chatting with people across the country. and you're having these conversations, you know, you're very, you know, conversational and friendly, and you can hear the tone in your voice with this. And so it's just so delightful. And I know I mentioned this to you the other day, but I'll mention it for the listeners. As I'm listening to these first few episodes, you know, I hear a researcher describing something from their study, and the researcher kind of goes on a little while about it, you know, and I hear myself in my head going, well, I want to know about what happened then, you know, oh my God, I wish Anna would ask, you know, what happened next? And oh my, if I'm just patient enough, you know, come hell or high water, you do, which is really awesome because you're the researcher thinking about, I want to know what happens next. And the other thing I just want to mention is that one of the things I really appreciated is that you will ask, you know, explain this to the listener, or what's the impact for the teacher? So, you know, there's an episode that, you know, we'll be releasing about the lack of the presentation of women and people of color in history of psychology textbooks. And so you interview the researchers who do that work. But then, you know, towards the end of the episode, the emphasis is really about, so what do you do if you're teaching that capstone class or that history class? What's the implication of your research? And so it's more than just presenting, you know, a synopsis of the research. It's what's the practical application for teachers of psychology? And you're doing that in episodes right now that range from about 16 minutes to 29 minutes, which is just perfect for binge listening.
Yeah. And I, you know, I really want the episodes to be, you know, accessible to everybody. You know, you don't have to be a researcher to listen to these. In fact, you know, I think it would be great if people who want to learn tips about teaching psychology are listening. I mean, they don't have a research background. And I tell every guest, one of the things I'm definitely going to ask you is, how could people use this in their classrooms? You know, how would this apply to specific classes or psychology classes in general? So I really want it to be useful for people and something that is helpful, useful for the teaching psych crowd.
Well, and I also think, you know, just as I listen to you say that, this could be very useful for any individual teaching research methods. Because what other opportunity do we get to have a researcher explain her or his or their own research in their own voice to an audience?
Yeah. I mean, the other exciting thing is so far, all the guests have been very excited to be on and talk about their research. And, you know, that's just a fun process. I love being able to highlight interesting research and great researchers.
Well, think about this. We the three of us, along with, I believe, Regan, put together a presentation a couple years ago about non-traditional contributions to psychology, scholarly contributions. And this really falls into that category. And I think that researchers there's been one avenue for them to get their research out in history, right? And that is by doing the traditional, you know, submission. And I don't know that there are many, and maybe you guys can correct me, is there another way to get this information out other than if they have their own blog or podcast or something like that?
There's been some interesting research about the research articles that are tweeted out. I know about those in terms of how many downloads there might be or views based on that. And so, you know, I think in general, we do know that these kinds of social media or non-traditional ways of reaching out actually do then help people be able to see it, get it sort of like publicized or out there a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, there are some things emerging like OSF websites where you can put things out. And, you know, researchers still argue about things like an H index or an I index. And, you know, do you count research or not? You know, I think the thing about, you know, Anna's SoTL PsychSessions feature is that, you know, it doesn't replace, obviously, you know, publishing, but it gives researchers another way to promote their own work. And, you know, in the show notes and in the release notes to every episode, we'll provide a URL or a bit.ly or some sort of shortcut, tiny URL, so that folks can at least see a link to the article. We may not be able to provide the actual article due to copyright, but we'll point them to the original work. And so, you know, the researcher will, you know, may get, you know, will get more exposure to their work in that manner as well.
Yeah. And I just want to point out for any listener who doesn't have access to journal articles like that, you know, the technically correct legal way to do that is to email the author and request a copy. And I know so far, I'm going to just put it out there that I think any guest that I've had so far has been kind and gracious. And I believe that they would be happy to send you their article if you're interested.
Well, you have recorded a handful of these already, Anna. What has surprised you about the first five or so conversations you've had?
Well, you know, it's interesting to Eric saying that I'm doing such a good job, because I feel kind of like also in the area where I'm in, I've only taught in-person courses as a professor, and now I'm going online. I feel like a little bit of a wobbly fawn trying to figure out what to do. I feel like I'm doing that a little bit with the podcast also. I'm trying to figure out, you know, what is my style and how does this work? But I, you know, I've loved the conversations. And, you know, it's kind of like, you know, when you talk to students and they light up about a subject, that's the conversations I'm finding. As for what I've learned, one of the most embarrassing lessons I had is that, as it turns out, the first couple of episodes, I had the microphone headset. I had that on backwards.
Well, at least nobody could see you, right?
Yeah, nobody could see me. It all worked. Apparently, the sound still worked. And I was kind of like, well, why is it set up like this? And then, yeah.
Well, and you know, I think people, Anna, you and me and Garth included, we tend to be hypercritical of ourselves. But Anna, I'm recalling, and again, you posted it, you know, very generously, I believe, on Twitter and on Instagram, from your recording your videos from the COVID pivot, you recorded your outtakes and you stitched them together in an amazing gag reel and posted the gag reel set to music, by the way, you know, online. So anybody who has that talent and that confidence to do that in their first semester teaching online, you know, odds are you're going to pick up this audio gig here pretty quickly.
Yeah. Yeah. I was just, I was invited to a talk in a class yesterday, and the person introducing me, he said, yeah, I know Anna, she throws herself into new things. And then later on, she says, I'm never going to do that. And then she does.
Right. Well, something interesting comes along, something, you know, and in all seriousness, it's Psych Sessions and our listeners who are going to be the beneficiaries. And we are seriously so excited to see what you do with this. You know, the analogy that I like to use, and it may not be a perfect analogy, is if you think back to The Daily Show, whether it's Trevor Noah or Jon Stewart, and they have features on there. And these feature editors go off and they do their own thing and they can interview whoever they want. And then they're played on the broadcast. And again, it's not a perfect analogy. We don't have broadcasts, but you know, you're your feature editor and you get to interview researchers and, you know, and so I love that model to the extent that, you know, the analogy works, that you're just doing your own gig and we get to be the beneficiaries of watching and listening to what you create.
I thought that maybe we should do some nuts and bolts things to finish up today. And Anna, could you just talk to us a little bit about how you are finding researchers right now, how you would like that process to go? Is there anything you want to share with our audience about just if they want to become involved in Psych Sessions? Is that an invitation that you will be sending out to them? Should people contact you? What's your thoughts?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, right now I am using my psych info skills and my knowledge of SoTL journals combined to find interesting articles I want to talk about. But I'm absolutely open. If there's something I missed, you know, from more recent times or even maybe a few years ago that's relevant now, you know, especially with a lot of courses going online, for example. I'm absolutely open to that. I don't yet have a formal way to do that, but you are, you know, I think listeners are welcome to email me and see if the article would fit in with the podcast.
Fantastic. Is there anything else you want to share about SoTL Psych Sessions before we sign off for this first episode?
Well, just that I'm very excited to be a part of it. And I'm looking forward to everybody listening to some of these great episodes. I'm very grateful for the people who have been guests when I say, oh, it's a podcast, but it's not out yet. And who have come on and done a lovely job of explaining their research. So I'm excited.
Yeah. Well, we are very excited. The first five episodes that I've heard are absolutely wonderful. Immediately helpful for me in my courses, and really have just become very energizing for me to listen to. So I think it's doing its job. You're doing a fantastic job hosting this thing, Eric. You wanna close this out? You got any thoughts?
Well, I just want to say, Anna, thank you for taking a flyer on us, and you know, Garth and I, you know, I know it's probably overused. We do tend to fly the plane and assemble it at the same time. So we do appreciate your patience as we assemble the nuts and bolts while trying to fly. And so thanks for your patience. And as always, we appreciate our listeners. We're you know, COVID-19, if nothing else, kind of, you know, forced us to think about recording over the internet. And so our preference had always been to record face to face, and I think we'll get back to that someday. But you know, when you give yourself the freedom to record over the internet, other things open up, and so we're cooking up more ideas here at Psych Sessions World Headquarters. And keep listening, because I think we'll have more ideas to share.
Thanks.